feedback.
I can't believe. What's cool about it? I'm stupid.
They joined a weary pair. They sought for shelter from the cold night air. Some place where she could lay her head, where she could give her babe a quiet bed. Was there no room, no corner there in all the town, a spot someone could spare? Was there no soul come to their aid? A stable bare was where the family stayed. Do you have room for a savior, and do you seek him anew? Have you a place for the one who lived and died?
Tells us in Isaiah 9:6, for unto us a child is born, for unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Hi, I'm Lisa Dennis Sparks, host of Believer Central World Update. From all of us at Christians United Broadcasting Network, may you have a wonderful Merry Christmas and a glorious New Year as we await together the soon return of the Lord Jesus Christ. God bless you and have a wonderful holiday.
Would you have come that night? Would you have sung the
Welcome to CUBN.
Will you seek the light? Do you have
Are we up? We're blurry. Or can't, my camera's blurry. That might be merciful to my audience.
Let me cover it up.
Okay. Is that better? More down? More down? You're going to be looking at my toes. I'm orange. Why am I orange? I'm green. I'm green. Hi, Julie. Hi, thank you. You're really sweet. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Believer Central World Update. Your host is a mess today. I don't have my makeup finished. I'm just like getting thrown onto the air without being all put together. But hey, Wonder Woman says I look antiqued. Hey, well, I am kind of antique. Okay. I am antique. Oh, green jello, green jello. Oh, Sherry, thank you. You love me, don't you? You're beautiful too. I'm not, but you know, oh my goodness, I am totally not finished with myself, okay? Sorry. What? Sorry. Maybe if I go like this a little bit, it won't be so bad. Oh my gosh, I don't even have my lipstick on. Look, I'm terrible. I'm sorry. I apologize. Oh my gosh. I've been messing with that camera trying to get it to work. Oh, I'm so sorry. Okay, well, you know what? What can I say? Wait, hey, you guys got off really lucky because at least I had, you know, my foundation on. You didn't have to see the worst part of it. See, I got burnt several years ago, so I have scars, you know, from being burnt that I have to cover up with this horrible makeup. Well, thank God for this makeup. I'm really thankful for it because, you know, usually you can't cover things like that. But they make this really special stuff that can cover burns and scars and so. Oh, thank you, Sherry. Sherry liked the nutshell today. Well, what do you think? Have you seen the secret? Yeah. What do you think about those? The nutshells are news, and the pearls are little Bible lessons. That's what they are. And I try to order. We'll see how that goes. You like the pearls? Shanna likes the pearls. Well, I hope that you'll be able to learn something. Oh, Cubans, am I breaking? Let me see what I can do. Maybe I can help a little bit in that area. You know what? Somebody from Taiwan hijacked my Skype account. Oh, can you hear me? Hi, Janine. Okay, can you guys hear me? Can you hear me? You can. Okay. So we're okay. Okay. Welcome to Believers in.
Welcome to CUBN.
I do hope we won't be having technical difficulties all day today. It's on my end, so I apologize. I really need more random access memory to make this smoother. But I can't afford to go get it. I have a child in college, and her books are like $1,000. So that's where, you know, no more random access memory for me. So God will provide it at some point, hopefully. But, you know, we may not need it if we're leaving. I just want to be able to stay on here long enough to give you the news. Okay. Let's see. God's Watchman is telling us something. What's he saying here? Here's the link where they explain in full the executive order that Obama, our dictator-in-chief, passed by executive order this past Friday. What is it? Can anybody tell me? Oh, the NDRP. NDRP. Well, you know what's going on in the news today? Oh, welcome all you guys in the chat room. Hello, Janine, Julie, Wonder Woman. Tag me home, Lord. Rapture ready. That's my Janine. And Shanna. I love you, Shanna. And everybody, welcome. I'm glad to have you here. Morsi from Egypt is running like a little girl. He has fled his palace. The people are trying to get in there and pull a Nero on him. And he took off. Who knows what's going to happen there in Egypt. But that's a bad, bad deal. Anyway. Oh, I have no idea what's going on in the chat room. Okay, let's see. Yeah, they run like a scaredy cat, Julie. You're right. Well, you know, he's got some problems. That's a bad situation. And we've also got a situation where Israel has asked Jordan for permission to fly over their territory to take out Syria's weapons of mass destruction. Well, see, Israel's on top of this whole thing. And we've been hearing about how they're trying to move chemical weapons around. Well, anybody who's going to know that first is going to be Israel. And they've already asked Jordan for approval to go through them and go through their territory and attack Syria's weapons of mass destruction sites. This is not looking good, guys. With every single day that comes, we are finding more and more evidence of really big events on the horizon. I'm so excited. I'll be so happy for the Lord to come for us, won't you? Okay. Since I'm a little, you know, well, I'm kind of myself today, okay? I'm normally I need to pray and ask the king. Well, there's a few things we need to ask the king, really. If you have any prayer requests, now's the time to toss them out there. We need to pray for Miss Paige. She's not feeling well. She's gone over to the ER, and I've asked her to let me know how she's doing when she gets back. Let's see. She said, please pray for me. She's going to the ER. She just hasn't felt well lately, and hopefully she'll be okay. She's in school, and I don't know. She's got some things going on to where she can't always be here. But she let me know in a message that she was going to go over to the ER, that she's not feeling very good. Julie says she has a few people who are on the verge of accepting Christ. They need prayer. Let's see. Pray for Gary. Oh, a coworker. His dad died. I'm sorry. Well, hopefully he knows Jesus and his dad knows Jesus so they can see each other again. Hi, Melanie. Okay, Karen's surgery. I don't know if I can figure out. Let's see. We are going to go before the King and take all of these needs in prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, your precious, wonderful Son, who we adore so much, we pray, Lord, that you would permit us to come before you and place our requests before you, my King. All of these requests in the chat room, O Lord, as you see them listed on the list, I pray that you would consider each and every one and grant each and every one, O Lord, in the name that is above every name, the mighty name of Jesus. And we include Paige with these requests, my Lord. And Gary and Karen's surgery and all of these requests, Lord, we just ask you to comfort Gary's family, to protect Karen through her surgery. If there are any others that I am not remembering, Lord, or are on the list, I pray that you consider those and grant those as well, O Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Permit us, my King, I pray, to sit at thy feet and learn from you. Grant us the spirit of understanding into your word, O Lord, we pray, in Jesus' name. Cause us to be pleasing to you, Lord. And I give unto you all that I am, my King. Take full control of everything I think, say, and do. And may all things be to your glory that come from this gathering, O Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, guys. Let's check out the news. I want to tell you about this site real quick. It's called Who's Who in Bible Prophecy. It's through soundchristian.com. I get people a lot who will come to my wall and ask me if a certain teacher is a good teacher, bad teacher. You know, I don't like to judge people. And I can't really make those kind of judgments if I have not, you know, check them out and done a history and all this stuff. And a lot of times I just really don't have time to go in and listen to a lot of their stuff and figure out for somebody if someone's a false teacher. But God has provided us a way. We have Who's Who in Bible Prophecy at soundchristian.com. Okay. If you just put in your little Google search bar, Who's Who, like W-H-O apostrophe S, W-H-O. Who's Who in Bible Prophecy. And it gives you all of the published teachers, and it gives you the teachers on TV. Now, I'm not important enough to be on that list. But you're going to find that they're right on when they say, this guy's a good teacher, this guy's iffy, this guy's not a bad teacher, and or whatever, you know. So you can... You know, if you're concerned about the credibility of the teacher you're sitting under, and you should be, you always should be, check, make sure they provide scripture for everything and verify. Now, I was kind of distressed this morning because I couldn't get the scriptures embedded into the nutshell and into the pearl before I had to upload them. So forgive me on that. I might have to cut back on this broadcast if I can't. Or on those videos, if I can't take the time to embed the scriptures with them, because it's pointless without the scriptures. So, but those of you who I have seen the scriptures before that I posted for you. Hopefully those will be real helpful to you. And anyone with a concordance can find those things as I quoted them in the videos. Who's Who in Bible Prophecy? Okay. You can go there and find out how they're rated. Okay. I just had somebody ask me this morning, and it turns out the preacher that they were wanting to know about it was a guy that came back with kind of a bad rating. So anyway, just check them, check what their doctrine is, you know, check with Who's Who in Bible Prophecy. I trust their rating system. It's reliable that I can see. We had a minor earthquake strike southern Maine. People reported feeling the ground rumble and houses shake, but there were no reports of injury or damages. The tremor was felt throughout much of southern Maine. There was darkness at noon in the mind of fearful Damascus. Dark is when the kidnappers come out to seek new victims, and the clashes raging on the outskirts creep ever closer to the heart of Damascus. For months, the people of Damascus have nervously watched their ancient city dragged deeper into Syria's bloody conflict. What would happen to our beautiful old city? It is mental torture. Last week, a rocket landed on my street. I know the fighting is getting closer. The dread is causing me physical pain. These are testimonies from residents of Damascus who need to, like, pack up their stuff and get the heck out of Dodge, okay? Because Damascus is going up soon. The Maritime Union says senators ask Atlantic Canadians to think big and merge provinces. Well, they're wanting to put, you know, they're wanting to get rid of all these borders, and they're wanting to turn Mexico, Canada, and the United States into one North American Union with the Amero as our currency. But, you know, I think, rather than going to the Mario, we may end up finding ourselves going straight to digital currency, you know, either if we either go over the fiscal cliff or, you know, we'll see what happens. Now, U.S., Israel, Turkey, and Jordan are all primed to strike if Assad activates chemical weapons. This is getting serious, guys. You know, we do know Damascus goes up, so, and we know that Assad, he's fighting the Muslim Brotherhood trying to take over his country. Now, I'm not saying Assad's a good guy, but he's fighting Al-Qaeda and he's fighting the Muslim Brotherhood, which is what I thought we were supposed to be doing too, you know? But now we find out through that mess that happened in Libya when our ambassador was killed, that our ambassador was a gun runner who was supplying the Muslim Brotherhood in Syria with weapons to fight Assad. So all of this goes back to our president. It's a mess. Shame on him. He should not be over there. He shouldn't even be over there at all. You know, we should not even be over there. We have oil reserves of our own. We do not need to go over there for that. Likud hopeful prays on the Temple Mount, breaking the taboo. Likud politician Moshe Feiglin on Monday violated the unwritten rule that prohibits Jews from practicing religion on the Temple Mount as he prayed at the holy site. Feiglin recently wrote his political vision on Facebook, remarking that the mission would be over when we build the Jewish temple on top of the Temple Mount and fulfill our purpose in the land. Well, you know the Muslims are going to hate that. Let's see what their reaction is. It says here, he's a political hardliner. Number 15 on the Likud list for the upcoming elections and head of the Jewish leadership faction within the right-wing party, a nationalist group defined by many as extreme. Well, I like this man's extreme, extreme thoughts. He prayed on the Temple Mount. Rock on. Footage obtained by Channel 10 showed a group of Jews, including the likely future member of the Knesset, as they prayed on the Temple Mount. Fagan recently wrote his political vision on Facebook, remarking that the vision would be over when we build the Jewish temple on the top of the Temple Mount and fulfill our purpose in the land. Glory to God. Although there is no law against Jews praying on the Temple Mount, for years both Israeli officials and the Islamic Waqf, the religious group in charge of managing the site, have told Jews not to carry out religious ceremonies or prayers at the site for fear of violence and a potential outbreak of riots. Well, isn't this a good time for that member, the hopeful member of Knesset, to go pray on the Temple Mount? You know the Muslims are going to love that. The site is considered the holiest in Judaism as the site of the first and second temples. The Esplanade is also referred by Muslims as the place where Muhammad ascended to heaven. Well, the Jews are going to build that temple on the Temple Mount after the treaty is signed. And it looks like that'll be somewhere in, you know, somewhere within the Tetrad. The Tetrad of Blood Moons is coming. Four full blood red moons on Passover Tabernacles, Passover Tabernacles. 2 years in a row. And these tetrads in the past have marked major events for Israel. The first one that came during the prophetic generation marked the birth of Israel. The second one that came in 1967 and 68 marked the recapture of Jerusalem. And then the tetrad that is coming in 2014 and 2015 looks to me like it's marking the tribulation period starting sometime probably in fall of 2014. No, I could be wrong. I mean, I'm just making educated guesses for you. I'm an analyst, not a prophet. So, but that's what it looks like to me. If the tetrads indicate the trib, you know, like I think that they may. They do seem to. I thought they were marking wars, and they do, but they're marking more than that. They're marking major events in Israel's history. Okay. This guy who prayed on the Temple Mount, rock on, you know, that, you know, I'm glad too. It's from the Times of Israel, for Wednesday, December 5th. That's tomorrow, but it's already tomorrow there. Okay. In Israel. Let's see what else is going on. This is from the Times of Israel. Yeah. You can go and read that article at the Times there. Prophecy 101, and now in Tel Aviv. Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Amos were naturals to the world of prophecy, but today's budding conduits to the heavens will soon be able to learn the art of forecasting in the classroom at a new school opening up in Tel Aviv. Named after Cain and Abel, the new institute's goal is to give the young generation of prophets tools and guidance on their way to the truth. This is amazing. They have opened up a school for the prophets in Tel Aviv. Now, these budding young generation here of Jewish young men are going to be trained by the two witnesses during immediately after the rapture and all the way up to the point where they are assassinated by the Antichrist. Now, this is fascinating to see this happening. We're seeing the school open up that's going to train the 144,000. And see, the 144,000 aren't called as first fruits until after the rapture. So see, all of these events that happen after we leave are starting to present themselves. And that's very, well, not just starting, they've been doing it for quite some time. And so it's awesome. It's awesome to see this. What do you guys think in the chat room? Isn't this cool? And have you seen this about the 144,000? Now, it doesn't say there's 144,000 students, but the two witnesses will have 144,000 students after the rapture occurs, because the scales will fall from their eyes like it did for Paul, and they will just all of a sudden recognize the Savior. They will know who he is. And they're going to cover the place. They're going to cover the land of Israel. They're going to cover the entire earth with the gospel message in a very short period of time. There are 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes of Israel. And the two witnesses that are going to be training them, you know, they come with Jesus when he comes for the rapture saints to take us out of here. And they stay here. That's the wedding tradition, the Jewish wedding tradition. As the groom comes with his two friends to collect his bride, he takes off with her, and the two friends stay at the bride's house to tell everyone where she went. And that is exactly what's going to happen. The two witnesses are going to be here to tell everyone where we went and train the 144,000. Oh, it's going to be fabulous, fabulous. I just love it that all of these events are just coming together so beautifully. It is not going to be long until we leave. It's just really, it can't be very long before we go. So, yeah, it's amazing. Oh, I do too, Melanie. She says she gets excited when I talk about this stuff. I do too, because it's fascinating. You know, we've got all of these amazing things happening in the world and all this prophecy coming together. This is it, guys. I mean, this is it. That, you know, those are three really scary words to a prophecy teacher, but I'm telling you, this is it. And everybody, you know, that I respect out there in the prophetic world is also saying the same thing. They're saying, this is it. This is it. Be ready. We're leaving. This is it, guys. I really believe that. I don't doubt it at all from the evidence that I see. It, you know, the prophetic pattern is progressing perfectly. 100% accurately, on schedule, on target, everything. There's no more doubt anymore that this is it, guys. These wars that are forming over there are going to be the Second Seal Judgment Wars and the Ezekiel 38 war. And, you know, I had told you that I really believe the Psalm 83 war started when Israel was born. And that is the continuous on-off war between Israel and the Muslim radicals, like Hamas, Hezbollah, all these that want to see Israel destroyed. And this is a fascinating time for Israel. I know their people are scared a lot. I have a friend that lives over there. Her name is Michelle. I love you, Michelle. Mwah. And her friend Rebecca, they have started a Bible study over there. You know, I've known her for 15 years, and we've talked many, many times about Jesus, of course. You know, I can't even have a conversation with anybody without bringing him up. And but she, you know, the Jewish people have a blindness. You know, her dad's a synagogue leader, and he was injured a while back, so he's not doing that right now. But she, you know, listened politely to everything I would tell her, but I don't think she could really buy it. Now, the Spirit just was not willing to show her at that time. But we talked a couple days ago, and oh my goodness, it was wonderful. She said that from our conversation the previous day, that she had gone and studied about Abraham and God. See, because she doesn't know her history all the way, her biblical history, you know? I mean, the people are secular. They don't know God. They don't remember their God. And so I was trying to get her to remember her God and telling her how special and wonderful she is, and explaining to her why the wars, why the whole world hates Israel. It's because the world is jealous, and because the world wants to eradicate the knowledge of God off the face of the planet. everybody has resented since time, you know, since the flood, that Israel is chosen. Okay? Israel is God's chosen people. I'm not a Jew, but I can read the Bible. You know, just because it doesn't say that, you know, the people of my bloodlines were chosen, that doesn't mean I'm going to just ignore it. You know, you precious Arab people, Israel's God is God. Israel's God is your God. Okay? Now, pride and selfishness and anger have been used as tools to separate you from your Israeli brethren. Isaac and Ishmael were brothers. Okay? I know you wish it was Ishmael who had inherited the blessing, but it's not the way it worked out. Remember, several times, it was not the firstborn who inherited. Abraham's second son, Isaac, inherited. Isaac's second son, Jacob, inherited. And Jacob's second to the youngest son, his 11th son, inherited. Now, this fourth son, Judah, it was the line of the Messiah. But see, it has skipped the firstborns for those first several generations. So it's not a diss on you. It's not nobody's spitting in your face by taking Ishmael's blessing. That's just how God did it. Okay? Get over it. Bless the Jews so you can get blessed too, because the God of Abraham is your God as well. Isn't that fascinating, though, that they're doing this in Tel Aviv? It says here, named after Cain and Abel, the new institute's goal is to give the young generation of prophets tools and guidance on their way to the truth. Set in the heart of Tel Aviv, Shmuel. Okay. Sorry, Shmuel. I'm not trying to mess up your name. Portman Haparti. Okay. That's the rest of his name. I'm sorry. I totally butchered your name. Forgive me. A self-named Messianic Shabbat follower. Hopes to teach people all they need to know to become prophets of the Jewish people. Yedioth Aronoth reported on Monday. Official Shabbat has criticized the initiative. Oh, why are they criticizing it? Well, you know, I think that they're going to criticize it as long as this guy here is running it. But when the two witnesses show up, they'll just hand it over, is what will happen. You know, somebody's got to have it ready for them to take over. While the Bible's filled with prophecies, rabbinical Jewish tradition generally holds that the idea of God talking to man ended when the temple was destroyed, and that wisdom is preferable to a prophecy of fools. But this generation is different than the ones before. It's taking an active part in the process of redemption. The school's aim is to provide the students with official sources through which to direct their spiritual experience toward the path of truth. See, it's all messed up until the two witnesses get a hold of it, isn't it? Let's see. 10 students have registered and are due to start later in the week. Others can join for a symbolic 10-week course, the founder told the paper. Among the skills he plans to teach are the correct way to read body language, dreams, and their meanings. You can't teach dreams, interpretation. Joseph was able to do that with God's help, and Daniel was able to do that with God's help, but God has to specifically give you the ability to interpret dreams. It's not something that you can learn. The ways of angels and the meaning and the means of advancing so as to be able to understand God's wisdom and life. Be careful if you listen to a teacher that tells you, you know, they alone can convey God's wisdom. The wisdom comes from the scriptures. Let every man be a liar and God be true. And when I say man, I include all of humanity. in that, myself included. They say, it's a shame that bizarre and weird people who don't represent Shabbat use the movement for the wrong purpose while damaging the memory of the Rebbe, Menachem Mendel Schneerson, the official Toad Yeti. Well, the school's going to, we know why the school's going to be necessary. Mohammed Morsi has fled his presidential palace, though. I told you about that, but I haven't read you the article yet. this guy. At least 100,000 Egyptians forced Egyptian President Mohammed Morsi out of the presidential palace on Tuesday to protest his assumption of nearly unrestricted powers and a draft constitution hurriedly adopted by his allies.
Uh-oh. Did I just blow right through my...
Okay, I didn't even notice, you know, when the bottom of the hour came. Let's just keep going, CUB, until the top of the hour, okay? I don't need a break, or else I would have noticed, huh? Okay. They're protesting his assumption of nearly unrestricted powers in a draft constitution hurriedly adopted by his allies. You know, he's assumed the powers of a pharaoh, and the pharaoh is on the fly now. Let's see. Police fired tear gas at protesters who attempted to get past the barbed wire-topped barricade, cordoning off the palace in Cairo's Heliopolis neighborhood, but the protesters broke through nonetheless. Well, don't you feel happy that they aren't just protesting Israel? You know, they protest their own president, too. Good. I think that's, you know, give equal time there. With the barricade crossed, protesters moved closer to the palace's walls, and the police apparently chose not to try and push the crowds back, like they could have. There's 100,000 people. You cannot force 100,000 people back. You just can't do it. I mean, they would end up firing into the crowds and everything to try to do that. The brief outburst of violence left 18 people injured, none seriously, according to the official MENA news agency. Demonstrators clanged incessantly on lampposts, waved Egyptian flags, and held aloft images of Morsi clad in a turban and Nazi uniform. Yeah. With the word void written in Arabic underneath. I thought they liked the Nazis. You know, they hate the Jews, and so it's really hard. Isn't it? Like the scripture says, all of these things are distress of nations with perplexity. With perplexity means it's complicated. It's a geopolitical thing, and it's a mess. Shortly after the clashes began, Morsi reportedly left the presidential palace. He took off like a little girl. Well, he should. There's 100,000 people knocking on his door. The president left the building through a back door when the crowds grew bigger, according to a presidential official who spoke on condition of anonymity because he was not authorized to speak to the media. Well, if he's not authorized to speak to the media, why is he speaking to the media? The boulevard near the presidential palace where protesters amassed was inundated with a seething horde of Kyrenes, with numbers estimated at over, at Kyrenes. That's people of Cairo. With numbers estimated at over 100,000 on Al-Nadi, a broad avenue outside the palace, and thousands more on nearby streets. Thousands more congregated in the city's main Tahrir Square. Protesters also commandeered two police vans, climbing atop the armored vehicles to jubilantly wave Egypt's red, white, and black flag and chant against Morsi. Well, Morsi's getting a taste of what it's like for Israel to be in Israel's shoes, isn't he? I think that's kind of funny, really. Nearly 2 hours into the demonstration, protesters were mingling freely with the black-clad riot police, with many waving the flag and chanting against Morsi. The crowd was chanting, Erhal, Erhal, Arabic for leave, leave. And the people want to topple the regime. They say that, they said that for Mubarak too. Now they're saying it again, that people want to topple the regime. Two well-known chants from the 2010-2011 Arab Spring Revolts. I remember those, that toppled former President Hosni Mubarak and other Middle Eastern and North African rulers. One commentator, Nasser Amin of the Arab Independent Judiciary Center, told Egypt's On TV that the demands were escalating every hour and that the Egyptians may soon ask to put Morsi on trial as they did Mubarak. Well, if that happens, then he's not the fierce king that they're talking about, because it looks like the people are more fierce, doesn't it? Associated Press reporter Sarah Aldeeb, who was embedded outside the presidential palace, reported that the demonstrators chanted, "We don't want military rulers or brotherhood to rule in name of religion." The Egyptian people don't want Islam crammed down their throats. Okay? They don't want the... Even Muslims don't want the Muslim Brotherhood to rule because of the way they do it, you know? It's just... Anyway. The root of the conflict is not the settlements, but Israel's very existence, is what Mr. Prime Minister Netanyahu has said. He's right, you know, the EU is going to kind of get over it, I think, about the settlements. But Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu on Tuesday dismissed heavy criticism of Israel's recent announcement of new housing construction in East Jerusalem and the West Bank, saying the root of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict is not the settlement. It is the very existence of the State of Israel and the desire to wipe it off the face of the earth. Very well said, Mr. Prime Minister. He's right. He's right. It's not the settlements that are bugging them. It's just Israel being alive and breathing that's bugging them. So Israel might as well build. Speaking at a forum on public diplomacy held in Jerusalem, Netanyahu said that we must constantly repeat that the root of the conflict is the very existence of the State of Israel, the refusal to recognize the State of Israel in any borders whatsoever. They want Israel to go back to the 1967 borders, but they're not going to recognize those either. So why do it? Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas, for his part, instructed his subordinates Tuesday to muster international support to halt Israeli settlements in all the Palestinian territories, particularly what is referred to as E1. We cannot be silent on the matter of settlements by any means, he added. We will pursue this endangering matter with great attention in the coming days, for if Israel continues to build, it indicates that it is not interested in arriving at peace. They need to just shut up. And if they think they're going to get hold of the land, why not encourage Israel to build on it? And then if they do get hold of the land, they can move into all those apartments that are already built, you know? But instead, they're like, oh, don't build, don't build. Well, build on, Israel, build on. Israel needs to just build everywhere. You know, I explained in one of these productions that I do, the Nutshell Pearl, the show here, I don't know. I explained in one of them that, when Israel pulled out of Gaza in 2005, they left the greenhouses, they left the food, they left the structure for everything intact. And the Palestinians, all they had to do is walk in there, move into a house that was already there, tend to the greenhouses that were already there and growing food, and make a living, you know, get on their feet. But you know what they did? They came in there with bulldozers and dozed the greenhouses, dozed the houses, dozed the apartments, dozed everything to the ground. How stupid is that? You know? They dozed everything to the ground. And they wonder why they don't have anything. Israel left it for them. Go figure. Let's see. Earlier on Tuesday, a senior Palestinian official warned that Israel's latest settlement plans would destroy any lingering hopes of setting up a Palestinian state next to Israel as international anger over the planned construction snowballed. Israel announced the plans in response to last week's UN General Assembly upgrade to non-member observer state status of Palestine in the West Bank, Gaza, and East Jerusalem, lands Israel captured in 1967. See, that's where it all goes back to there. The plans include 3,000 more homes for Jews in the West Bank. Well, why, if the Palestinians were smart, they'd say, build on, Israel, build us houses and that you're going to hand over to us, wouldn't they? Why are they throwing such a fit about Israel building houses on these lands that the Palestinians, if it does get handed over to them, they can just move right into them? They don't even have to build their own house. You'd think they'd be grateful and say, build on. Because, you know, those things benefit the Palestinians. All of that settlement building is going to benefit the Palestinians if they're the one that end up with the land. So what is the big deal? You know, the settlements, you ought to be paying Israel to build on that if you think it's eventually going to be your land. So it says the plans include 3,000 more homes for Jews in the West Bank and East Jerusalem, as well as preparations for construction of the especially sensitive E1 project that would link Jerusalem to the large settlement of Ma'ala Adumim to the east, potentially destroying the possibility of a contiguous Palestinian state in the West Bank. Israeli officials have stressed that the E1 announcement relates to a very preliminary planning stage. Well, I don't know. I think Israel ought to just do what the Arabs did to them in 1948 and go in there and take all their land back. Take Gaza, take the West Bank, take Golan, take Syria, take Lebanon, take Saudi Arabia, take Jordan, take Egypt, take it all. It's all going to belong to Israel eventually. Separately, Israel's moving forward with two major projects in Jewish neighborhoods in East Jerusalem. Israel would build more than 4,200 apartments in the two areas. See, I mean, now that would give Palestinians a place to live, wouldn't it? But instead, they want to complain. Oh, don't let Israel build. Don't let Israel build. You ought to be hoping Israel builds before you get your hands on it. That way, it's got something, you know. You got a house to move into instead of just a piece of dirt to stow a tin on. Anyway, Israeli settlement construction lies at the heart of a four-year breakdown in peace talks. It was a major factor behind the Palestinians' UN statehood bid. The Palestinians said they're so full of it. I love you, Arab people, but forgive me, those who are rabid against Israel and make these ridiculous arguments. Do you see how ridiculous it is for them to complain about Israel building on these lands? Israel, you know, is, if they really believe they're going to get the land, then they should encourage Israel to build on it so they'll have some place to live when the Israel has to hand it over. Just doesn't make sense, does it? You know, sin and wickedness never does make much sense. The EU says they won't punish Israel for settlement expansion plan. Well, that's refreshing. That's Britain's foreign minister. That's a bit of good news. The government poked Obama in the eye with new settlement instruction, Livni. That's Zippy Livni. She's a liberal to the core. She would give the whole land of Israel back, you know, back to him, back to these crazy people. See, they, God's not going to let her in there yet. She might be the one that's in there to sign the treaty, though, for him. With elections around the corner, is Netanyahu bluffing on the E1? Well, I'm not really, you know, I don't think I'm going to read that one. A fraught civil rights case, here's an end. In Israeli's high court, Lieberman boots Deputy Foreign Minister Ilan from Israel, Beit HaNews, Knesset Slate. Netanyahu joins Obama in warning Assad against using chemical weapons. You know, Israel is on top of this chemical weapons situation. And you know what? You might just see the destruction of Damascus any day. Well, I really think that we're going to leave first. But there is nothing that specifically says we're going to leave first. Now, here's why I think we're going to leave first, okay? I think we're going to leave first because the world is spiritually asleep when the rapture occurs, okay? And a nuclear detonation of Damascus is going to wake people up, okay, spiritually. And that's why I think, you know, multitudes and multitudes, most people who are going to come to the Lord Jesus Christ are going to come after the rapture. God's Watchman says, oh, you're talking about cell towers and the mark and all that. Yeah, you know, do you know if you have the chip? The chip might or might not be the mark. I'm not willing to take a chance. I'm telling everybody, don't take one. And whether it's the mark or not, even if it's not the mark, don't take one. Because if, oh, Christina, hi. She wants to know what Stargates are. I'll answer you in just 1 second here. If the chip isn't the mark, once you refuse the mark, they can kill you by remote control for refusing it. I've been teaching people about this for quite some time. Now, they brag that they can defibrillate your heart remotely with an electrical charge that bounces off the satellite and down to shock you and start your heart back up. But you know what? That same life-saving electrical charge can also kill you if your heart is beating properly. It can stop your heart as well. So it's kind of like, you know, I'm not taking a chip, okay? I'm not taking a chip, and I don't care if it's the mark or not. If they want to put something in my hand or my forehead, I'm not doing it. I don't care what it is, all right? And I'm not gonna do it. But make them hunt you down the old-fashioned way, okay? If you're chipped, you can be tracked, located anywhere on the planet, on the highest mountain, down the deepest ocean. They can find you. There is truly no place to hide anymore once you have a chip implanted. They can find you anywhere. They can listen to your conversations. They can watch you by satellite on video. They can do anything they want once you're chipped. But you just forget about taking a chip. Make them hunt you down the old-fashioned way, okay? Don't let them exterminate you easily, like with the push of a button. Make them come and do it the old-fashioned way, okay? Make them hunt you down. Well, Julie wants to know, when will they start chipping? When the government put forth the Obamacare health legislation, they initially had put March of 2013 in the draft, which indicated that's when they felt like they would be ready to start implementing that program. But we just don't know. See, the date didn't pass in the Obamacare plan. So I think that, you know, just simply because they were trying to get that date in the plan, that I think that gives us adequate reason to believe that they could be ready to start chipping people to receive their benefits as early as March. You know, I think it's possible. And I bet you anything they could do it earlier, that they would be prepared to do it earlier if the rapture occurred. See, that's going to be why people get chipped. Because when the rapture occurs, you've got millions of people who have left behind all their identifying, you know, everything it takes to establish an identity. Millions of people have left all that behind. Well, how do you ever positively identify somebody ever again? Ever again? Well, the way you do that is with the chip. See? They say, well, we don't know who people are. We can't trust being able to do business with anybody. Well, the chip, once you're permanently identified with the chip, then they determine you safe to do business with. And so then you can participate in the global economy through a scan on your hand. Do not take a chip. Whether it's the mark or not is irrelevant. Because if it is the mark, you're toast. If it's not the mark, then they can kill you by remote control once the mark does show up, you know, and kill you that way without even having to leave the desk. Pick you off with one of those little drones. Boom, 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 boom. Like a video game. Okay. God's Watchman is mentioning the food crisis. Oh, now wait a minute. Christine asked me a question. What was it, sweetie? I want to get to your... Oh, the Stargates. Yes, dear. Thank you for reminding me. Okay. I really believe that the Stargate is a possibility. And I'll tell you why. I'm thinking that... oh, hey, Cuban. Are you there? CUBN? Hello? He says he'll be right back. Okay. Well, I'll just go through the top of the... I'll just go through the top of the hour break, too. I'm not about to touch any of these...
To the all-new CBN Praise from the Christian Broadcasting Network on CBN.com. CBN Radio.
Hope is here. Shout the news to everyone. It's a new day, peace has come. Jesus saves.
to let all the world know that Jesus saves. Raise a shout to let all the world know that Jesus saves.
Welcome back to Believer Central World Update on Christians United Broadcasting Network. You guys are cracking me up in the chat room. You're talking about all kinds of amazing things, huh? Illuminati, time travel, and things like that. I wanted to answer the question about the Stargates, Christine's question. I think that rather than being something mystical, that we are looking at technology as our method of travel. And because remember, you know, if things look supernatural, technology looks supernatural unless you understand how it works, doesn't it? You know, if you went back to the Dark Ages with a Bic lighter in your hand, I have one here. I haven't lit my candle, have I? I need to light my candle. If you went back in time with this right here, they would burn you at the stake as a witch. Did you know that? They would. They would burn you at the stake as a witch. And it's because that's just technology. Okay? It's only technology. And but I think that it's entirely possible that a stargate will open up and the Lord will just snatch us up. Snatch us up. Well, tell us what happened yesterday, God's Watchman. I'm looking here. Anon says, put a second television in front of the one they're watching you with. You know what? Oh, I lost it. I didn't get to see it before. It's gone forever now. I can't see it. Oh, wait. Maybe I can. Well, I can't keep up. I'm sorry, guys. you guys are just so fast, you know. Now I see, God's Watchman is talking about being unplugged from the Matrix. You know, there's a whole lot more truth to that than you might think. You know, the movie indicates that we're prisoners, you know, and don't even know it because the prison is for our minds. And I think that's true. I do think that's true. The Bible does say that, you know, everything around us is temporal. It's temporary. And the things that we don't see are the eternal things. So I'm kind of like Neo too. I don't want to live in the Matrix. I want to know the truth. I want to be set free from it, even if it's not as hunky-dory as it is in the Matrix. Remember the guy that wanted back in? He's kind of like it's crazy to make a deal with the devil because people expect him to keep his word. How dumb is that, you know? The devil's not going to keep his word, ever. He's the father of lies. So you can't make a deal with him. But I think you're right there. I think you're right there, guys, that, you know, that it's technology, you know, when we leave. Christine, does that answer your question, sweetie? I really do think it's probably some kind of a stargate that opens up and the Lord lifts us out. And then, Christina says, what does it do? What are you talking about? Are you talking to me or them? Or let's see. I think it's God's technology. Yeah. I think it's God's technology. I think God is just billions of years ahead of us in technology to the point to where, okay, Janine wants to know, why would he need a stargate? Well, here's the thing. We're going alive. Okay? Now, when Elijah and Moses traveled here, let's look at the word of the king in Matthew 17. Okay? Let's go over to Matthew 17. I got my coffee on the break and oh, it's so happy. You know, it's the cappuccino espresso. With the, Cool Whip and the little Hershey syrup. It's just so fabulous. Yes, we are meeting him in the clouds. That is correct. Let's go over to Matthew 17. I want to show you something really cool. Oh, my king, thank you. My Bible just turned right straight to it. I love it when he takes over and I don't have to worry about what I'm going to teach. He just leads and we follow. I love that. Now, Matthew 17 is showing us how Moses and Elijah show up on the Mount of Transfiguration, and Jesus is transfigured as well. They are all glowing. Let's read that real quick. Matthew chapter 17, and we'll start at verse 1, okay? And after 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was as white as the light. He's glowing. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias talking with him. Then answered Peter and said unto Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make here 3 tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And behold, a voice out of the cloud, which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore afraid. And Jesus came and touched them and said, Arise and be not afraid. And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. And I want to show you some really cool stuff about this passage, okay? Let's go all the way back up to verse 1. Now it says, after 6 days, he never puts anything in the scriptures pointlessly. Everything, every tiny little thing is important. So he's saying, after 6 days. Now we know that there were 6 days of creation, and then the seventh is to be the day of rest, the day of the Lord. Okay? Now, this 6 days corresponds with 2 Peter 3:8 that says, A day is as a thousand years, and a thousand years is as a day. Now, in God's timing, he's giving us the code to decipher all these things. So when he says after 6 days, what he's saying is he's saying at the end of the 6,000 years. That's right now. Okay? He's giving us timing. After 6,000 years, okay? So he's saying after 6 days, they went. Now get this. This is really cool. Check this out. Okay, after 6 days, we talked about how it means the 6,000 years. It says, Jesus took Peter, James, and John and brought them up into a high mountain apart. This is so cool. You'll love this. Now, after 6 days, okay, after the 6,000 years, Jesus brings Peter, James, and John up to the top of the mountain. Do you see the rapture? After 6 days, Jesus brings the three that loved him. Not the rest that just followed him and did what he said. The three that loved him. Do you see that? Do you see it? He took the three that loved him up. Do you see that? He took the three that loved him up. And was transfigured before them. Now, Moses and Elijah were real. They could be seen, felt, touched. The disciples saw them, and Peter thought that they needed to build tents for them to sleep in. So obviously they looked like we look, except they were glowing. And so they looked like they were real and were going to still walk down the mountain with them and all that. They looked real enough to where Peter thought they needed tents to stay the night in, but they glowed. So what this is, and we also see that Jesus, okay, we know, let's think about this for a second. We know Elijah and Moses are alive, like we're alive. Elijah was taken alive. He was raptured in 2 Kings. So he's been gone for, over 3,000 years, but he's still alive like we are. He hasn't aged and he hasn't died. So he's alive. And Moses, there was a dispute with the devil about the body of Moses. And so Moses obviously had his body too. And they looked real because the disciples wanted to build them tents. But they were, some kind of change had happened to them. They were glowing. It says here that the Lord was transfigured before them and his face did shine as the sun. And his raiment was as white as the light. So what's happened here is what I think is that the Lord Jesus is showing us that this change is a temporary thing. Okay? Jesus obviously changed and then changed back. Moses and Elijah, it looks like they had to change, become transfigured to make the trip to come and talk to Jesus. Because remember, they're alive. If you're alive and breathing and your heart's beating and all that, you can't travel through space, can you? And you can't, you know, I don't, evidently this transfiguration is some kind of protection for these people that are alive to be able to travel back and forth. And we know that when Jesus comes for us, these two witnesses right there that you see on the top of Mount Transfiguration, they're coming back with him. And when he takes off with us, he's going to take us and they're going to stay here, those two witnesses. And they're not going to glow the whole time they're here. Okay? They're going to lose their illumination or whatever, and they're going to train the 144,000. So this is some kind of a temporary change, I think, that protects us for the trip. Because we see that Moses and Elijah made the trip with this transfiguration. They glowed, they were luminous, but they're alive. They've never died. And they're just as alive as me and you. So, interesting, isn't it? Now, right, Enoch walked with God and suddenly he was not. God took him. There's been at least six raptures in the past that we know of. And Enoch, God just took him. Elijah, a chariot of fire, something that is transportation, looked like it's on fire, and came down out of the sky, picked Elijah up, and took off with him. Then you have the Lord Jesus. He ascended visibly while everybody watched. Then you have Philip. He was picked up from one part of the earth and set down at Azotus. You know, he was set back down in another location on the earth. See, the Lord, just because he raptures you doesn't mean that, you know, you automatically go to heaven. Because Philip, he picked Philip up off the earth and set him down in another town. And then you have Paul. He didn't know if he was in or out of his body when he went, but he was trained personally by the Lord Jesus Christ. Then you have John. Now, John is an interesting story because he was raptured both into heaven's future and into earth's future. So he not only went somewhere else, he went through time and then came back. And I'll say this, the devil is not able to time travel. You know how we know that? Anybody have an idea in the chat room? You know why the devil, how we know the devil can't time travel? Any ideas? I'll tell you how I know he can't time travel. I'll tell you how I know he can't time travel. Because if he could time travel, the one thing he would do is go back and not crucify the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. All right? That's where he messed up. So if he was able to time travel, that's the one thing he would go back and change. And he can't change it. There's no changing it. So he can't time travel, can he? That's my reasoning. I figure if the dude can time travel, he would go back and not crucify the Lord of Glory. Don't you? I mean, that was his defeat. I mean, if he's going to change anything, that's what he has to change. And it's not been changed, and it's never going to be changed. Okay? Nobody's ever going to undo the crucifixion. And so that's why I think Satan can't time travel. But John did, when God took him there, John did time travel. He time traveled into heaven's future and into earth's future. He saw our world that you see now. He saw our world and went back and wrote down what he saw. Isn't that cool? Well, you know, that's just my thoughts on the matter. I think that if the devil could time travel, that that's exactly where he would go and what he would do is undo his defeat. But he can't. And because he was, you know, he was salivating. He was like so happy to see Jesus crucified. He's thinking he's won. He's jumping up and down. He's singing. And then he comes out of the grave. Uh-oh. Evil can't time travel, Julie. I don't believe they can at all. I don't think so. They wouldn't be able to do. They can't do anything that the king doesn't allow them to do. Mm. Oh, that's so happy. You know, these are probably about a million calories, but if I only have one, I just have one while I'm doing my show. And then I'll, you know, I never have one if I'm not doing my show. I save it for when I'm doing my show because it gets cold in here. My feet get cold and this coffee just will warm me right up. Okay. Did you see the rapture in this passage? Isn't that cool? Were you able to see it? After 6 days, that means after 6,000 years, Jesus took the three disciples who loved him. Jesus took the ones who loved him up into the high mountain apart from the rest. Wow. That is showing us the rapture. Jesus took only the ones that loved him up that day and showed him that. And the ones that's it's symbolizing the rapture, Janine, is what it's doing. It's saying after 6 days, that's after 6,000 years. So it's telling us more than what the face value of the scripture is telling us. Do you follow me? This actually happened, and Jesus actually waited 6 days, and, you know, the whole nine. This was a literal thing, but This was a literal thing, but it's also foreshadowing the event to come, okay? Where Jesus takes those who love him up apart from the rest, and then those that are left below, down below, they're clueless about what's going on. Janine says, sounds like a replacement. What do you mean, sweetie? A replacement. I don't get it. Let's see. But neat theory on time travel Stargate. Some theorists think time travel with the pineal gland. I don't know. I have no idea. The rapture saints, the ones who love him. We are the ones that are going to go. Okay. Now, remember, this is kind of like the parable of the 10 virgins in a way, isn't it? Because you have the ones that love him get to go with him and participate in this cool thing. And the ones that are still getting to know him, and they just, you know, they will love Jesus and they will die for Jesus eventually. But they don't at that moment. Okay? They're still getting to know him and still finding out about him. And Jesus is still teaching them. But the ones, notice, the ones who love him are the ones who are getting the revelation. Okay? The ones who love him are the ones getting the revelation. Cuban, it looks like we're coming up on the bottom of the hour. I'll get a refill on my coffee if we can take a couple of minutes here. But then we'll come back and we will do more. Thank you, God's Watchman. I always just blow right through it usually. But we're going to take a quickie break. Stay tuned. We'll be right back with a whole lot more of God's Word. Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus. Come and breathe on us. Underwood. She can sing that song like nobody else can. She's amazing. Hey, Shanna, look what I got for you. It's a little baby sombrero. It's just for you. This is for Shanna. And it's not green, but it's a sombrero. Look, isn't it cool? not come up with a sombrero for your birthday, check it out. Isn't that just the cutest little thing you ever saw? Fits right in my hand. Oh, it's for my Shanna. Isn't that cute? She loves green sombreros. And so I thought I would just give her my little sombrero. Isn't that cute? For you, Shanna Banana. I love you. Okay. Now, shall we keep going with our Bible study? Okay, do you guys have any questions while we're at it? I know I do have a thingy here. Where is it? That had some questions on it. What did I do with it? Oh, maybe this is it. That's it? No, that's not it. Oh, here it is. Okay. All right, now, I was given a list of questions here. Let's see. God's Watchman says, went to a school Christmas program Friday night, and they could have given this one kid a sombrero and maracas because he was dancing through the whole thing, not waiting till the end when they were all to dance, talking about how they celebrate Feliz Navidad. I like that song too, you know. David wants to know, what is the seventh trumpet in the book of Revelation? Well, let's go take a look at it. And I think the seventh trumpet releases the seven vials, and it also brings an end to the mystery of God. There's another rapture right there at the seventh trumpet. Let me snag it here. Ah, the seventh trumpet, go to Revelation chapter 11, verse 15. While we're on that, Lisa, what's the difference between the trumpet, seals, bowls, etc.? Oh, okay. Did that fix us, CUBN? We're good now? Okay. Is it still not good? Is it okay now? Okay. All right, let's start reading at chapter 11, verse 15. And the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven, saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders which sat before God on their seats fell upon their faces and worshipped God. Now, see, that's a picture of rapture saints. Okay. Now this is 12 OT saints and 12 disciples. Okay. They are the 24 elders saying, we give thee thanks, O Lord God Almighty, which art and wast and art to come, because thou hast taken to thee thy great power and hast reigned. Now, let's see. Now, the difference between the seals, trumpets, and bowls. The bowls are also vial judgments. Now, the seal judgments are designed for repentance and correction. Okay? The trumpet judgments are a combination of repentance and correction and wrath. Okay? They're kind of a combination. But the wrath is not poured out in full mixture. Then the vial or bowl judgments are pure wrath. They are pure wrath. And as a matter of fact, we can go ahead, if you like, And go ahead and go see how many of these vile judgments we can get through, too, because we never did do the seventh trumpet or the seven vile judgments. And I keep promising Melanie I would get back to do that. God's Watchman says, let's see. Hi, Christina. Yes, three raptures. We have a rapture. We have another mass rapture. There has been one in the past when Jesus Christ ascended. When he was resurrected, he brought all the righteous dead from the OT, from the Old Testament, with him. And they were walking around Jerusalem. And he took them. That was a mass rapture when he ascended and took them all with him. And now we're going to have another mass rapture. The next one is a mass rapture. It's all the children, babies, unaccountable, and believers. And that closes off the parentheses in time between Daniel's 69th and 70th weeks of years. When that the rapture will close that parentheses, and then the treaty, when it is signed, starts the 70th week of years, which is the seven-year tribulation period. 1 week of years is 7 years. And so it's a total of 490 years to bring an end to iniquity and to put the Lord Jesus Christ on the throne. Glory to the King. Now, is it a celebration trumpet that is blasted when, let me see, I'm missing that. Okay. I was talking about what Christina's comment was on the three raptures. Yes, mass raptures next. That's our ride. And then after that, you have a rapture when the two witnesses are murdered by the Antichrist. They lay dead in the street for 3 days. God raises them up on international television live, and they ascend and are raptured when that happens, and everybody, the whole world sees it. Now, that one just says there's two witnesses, but I believe if God raptures, you know, them, he might just take the living saints that have accepted him as well. He might. So that's a rapture. Then the third rapture you have is at the seventh trumpet judgment, where it says the mystery of God is finished. Okay. And let's see. Now, let's see. Let me find the part where it says, okay, that the mystery of God is finished. Where is it? Fourth angel. Fifth angel. Sixth angel. Chapter 10, verse 7 in Revelation. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as he hath declared to his servants the prophets. Now, the mystery is the raptures, okay? Everywhere you find the mystery of God in the scriptures, it's talking about the raptures. And it's saying here that the mystery or the raptures are finished at the seventh trumpet judgment. So that's the last one. Okay, isn't it kind of interesting that you have this huge argument among the body of Christ as to pre, mid, and post. And then what's funny is that we have three raptures left, but a lot of people can't see. They see one rapture and then they don't see the other two. And so they think they just cling to the one, not realizing that there's more. There's been six in the past. There's at least three to come. And this is the mystery of God. Isn't it cool for him to rapture people? I love that. We talked about what's the difference between the trumpets, seals, and bowls. God's Watchman says, is it a celebration trumpet that it's blasted when Jesus finally takes over the world? Well, there's going to be lots of trumpets blown in the kingdom of heaven. Every time the king goes somewhere, they're going to blow a trumpet. You know, so, I mean, it's not, there is such a thing as the last trumpet judgment of the seven, and there is such a thing as the last trump, which is a specific type of blast that occurs during the Feast of Trumpets. You know, they have 100 blasts during the Feast of Trumpets, but they have three special ones. The first one's called the first trump. The middle one is called the great trump. And then the one that closes the feast is called the last trump. So that's why a lot of people believe that he'll come at the Feast of Trumpets. Janine wants to know, what happens to us after Satan is loosed upon the world again after our 1,000 years? Well, what we get to do, what happens to us, nothing happens to us. We're immortals. So, you know, we just look at these haters of God like, who are you, you know? Because they can't do anything to us, you know? We're immortals. They surround the city is what they do. Satan is released at the end of the 1,000 years, purposely, okay? God's had him caged. God chooses to release him again. He goes out to deceive the nations one more time and to gather all those who hate God and hate God's people together against the holy city. But there's no battle that time. The scripture just says that fire comes down out of heaven and devours them all instantly, and it's all over. Then you have the resurrection of the lost to appear before the great white throne judgment, and they are all judged. Nobody is saved that appears at the great white throne judgment. The books are open. They're judged according to their deeds. And they all go to hell because they didn't have the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. And so all of them are tossed, they're judged and tossed into the lake of fire that burneth forever and ever. And they're tossed out. So at the end of the millennium, you have only those who are willing to love and serve and obey the king. We worship him. You know, he's not bringing us there as servants, okay? I'm a servant of the Lord. But let me explain something to you. He doesn't bring us there to be his servant. He has tons of servants that he doesn't have to die for, okay? He didn't have to die for his servants. Everything serves him. He came and died for us because he wants us as his family. He wants us as his companions. We are going to be keeping him company. You know, what is, let's see, Clinna, did you ask a question that I need to find? Let's see. Let me go wait. Oh, I'm way, way up here. Here's a guy in our chat room with a very interesting name that I can't say on television. He says there is no marriage in heaven. Well, maybe you should tell God, because he's got a wedding feast prepared and the whole nine. I bet he'd really like to know that, so he wouldn't be wasting his time there, huh? He says, unless you believe like the Muslims and you get, I forgot how many versions. No, we don't believe like the Muslims. No, we don't. Anon says, it's so sad that people are going to hell eternally. I wish everybody would know Jesus. Well, the tares don't go. It doesn't belong to them. Okay? God isn't going to invite those who are not good guests into his home. Okay? He's not going to invite murderers and thieves and those who don't make good guests, is he? And that's the thing. I mean, if you want to kill people and steal from people and lie to people and have sex with people that you're not married to and these kind of things against God's commandments, then you don't really want to come to his house anyway, do you? You know, I mean, he is picky about who he invites. Okay? And before people think about how, well, it's just terrible that God doesn't, you know, save everybody. Well, that's just really hypocritical, because do you invite everybody into your house? Do you go down to the local jail and invite murderers and thieves and liars and rapists and all that into your house? If you do, then go ahead and throw some stones, okay? But God doesn't invite them into his house. I don't invite murderers and rapists and thieves into my house. I don't blame God for not, you know, how can it be heaven if you bring all of the bad there? And the bad can't come into heaven. It's just the way it is. It is sad that people are going to hell, but you know what? People make choices, okay? And some people don't make choices. Those who don't choose go to hell by default. Those who choose hell, of course, go to hell. And then you've got those who are tares. They're not invited. Only human beings, pure human beings, not the hybrids. The hybrids are not invited. Okay, they don't have a redemption plan. Jesus didn't die for them, and they have to go to hell. But keep in mind, our Creator has built us a magnificent training program here. It's like a training program on a computer that's a virtual reality, in a way, because He is training us. And these people who are tares, they are not the wheat. It's not like they have a choice, okay? They are tares. That is what they are, okay? It's, you can't turn a dog into a human being. And that's kind of what the Nephilim are. They're creatures. They're not human. Now, they're walking around in a human body, but what they are on the inside is not the same as what we are. Jesus didn't die for them, didn't give them a redemption plan. And so they're going to hell because they were created to go to hell. They were created for that purpose. Now, remember that God is just in everything he does. What makes you think that these Nephilim aren't just a computer program? I think it's entirely possible that the lost and the Nephilim are a computer program. They're computer characters, I think. You know, since they don't have a redemption program, they're not real. And it's entirely possible that they're just computer program. And, you know, if you toss out a computer program, it's not going to sit there in the trash and cry. Okay? It's not a real person. Okay? I really think that that's the case. Because our king is not, you know, he doesn't delight in destroying things. I think what has happened is he's created mankind because he's looking for companionship. He's created these, he's created these tares as training tools in the program to help challenge us. And stuff like that, right? Well, when he tosses them out, they're not going to feel agony if they're just a computer program. You know what I mean? Our God is just. Our God is just. Did you know that nobody's going to go to hell that he didn't already know was going to go to hell before he ever created them? Did you know that? And the word says, let's flip over to Isaiah. Did we ever read the scripture over here? Yeah. Let's flip over to Isaiah chapter 46. We just have just a couple minutes left. Dang, this show goes by so fast. Isaiah chapter 46. Must be 40. Oh, yeah. 46:9. Okay? Are you ready? Remember the former things of old. For I am God, and there is none else. I am God, and there is none like me. He's alone. He's one of a kind. He's the only one of his kind. That's why he had to create an adversary and all that just to give us a choice. Declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times the things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do all my pleasure. Calling a ravenous bird from the east, the man that executeth my counsel from a far country, yea, I have spoken it, I will also bring it to pass. I have purposed it, I also will do it. Do you know what he's saying here? He's saying that anybody who goes to hell does so by design. Isn't he? Because if nothing defies him, nothing defies him. Nobody's going to go to hell who is one of God's children. The only ones that go to hell are the ones who have been created and designed from the very beginning to be training tools, and they will go to hell. Now, there are, I believe it is true that there are some human beings that are lost, but that's also by design. God knew them before they were created, and God just doesn't like some people. Don't tell me, do you like everybody? God hated Esau. Because of the way Esau thought. You know what I mean? But that's, anyway, this is a really deep discussion and it's time to go already. I can't believe it. But we will, we can get into this again another time. God bless you. Thank you so much for, you know, taking the time to come and hang out with us here at Believer Central World Update. We love you so much. God bless you. And to the Lord, Terry, we'll see you again soon, hopefully tomorrow, here, there, or in the air. Bye, guys. I love you.
December, the city streets and shopping malls. I wish we could slow down and remember the meaning of it all. Wherever you are, no matter how far, come back to the heart of Christmas. Live while you can. Cherish the moment, the ones that you love. Make sure they know it and don't miss it. The heart of Christmas. Let's make it feel the way it used to. Find the wonder of a child. You can see the magic all around you. Come on and open up your eyes. You can find it in the warm embrace of your family, or calling up a long lost friend. You can even find it in the eyes. Why?